All right, so I guess we're already a little bit late, so let's get started. I hope you are all here to hear something about default content, which is what I wanted to tell you a little bit about. I am Tobias. I'm T. Stöckler, or T. Stöckler on Drupal.org, and I work for Biologis in, here in Frankfurt. Yeah, all right, so let's get started. In general, if you have any questions or any comments, just yell at me or just say something. Okay. So basically, the first part, I basically want to get to the point of like what is default content and why am I even here talking to you about this. So the problem that I'm sort of trying to describe that you sometimes have when you're building a site is that you want content on your site. For instance, you have some bug on the live side, on the production side, that you want to reproduce on your local development instance, or you're building something new for the client and you need some content to sort of try out, does it really work? Or also for automated testing, you need some content to actually do the test set to make sure that your site actually works. So by default, if you just install Drupal, you don't have any content at all. You can see that you have like a little block over there, so you have your configuration and maybe you have some views and stuff like that, but you don't have any content. So your site is actually pretty useless and you can't actually make sure that that it works functionally. You also can't really make sure that the design works because there's nothing there. And this is not just for Drupal core. This is here I tried the Thunder distribution, and because that actually comes with some default content. But if you actually don't, like you can basically opt out of installing the default content, and then this is what you get. So it's not useful at all, and you can't do anything with it. So how would we solve this problem of getting content on your local site? There are a bunch of different options. Of course, sort of the brute force, most simple option is just to add content to your site. But that's not a very scalable solution, depending on how much content you want. And usually, if you're a developer, you're lazy, so you just type ASDF, ASDF everywhere, and then your site looks pretty shitty and not actually like an actual site, because actual sites don't have ASDF everywhere. So that's not a very good solution. And it also takes a lot of time. So another solution is using some sort of like randomly generated content. You can use the develop generate module for that. That, for example, comes with the drush command that you can just... can you actually read this, by the way, with the resolution? Is that fine? Okay, perfect. So you can just tell develop generate to, in this case, to create 10 nodes for you. And then you get something like this, with like a lorem ipsum text, and they're all, you know, you can, there are also some cool plugins that instead of these example images, you have like nice kitten images or stuff like that. But still, it's not, this can be a really useful tool, but often enough, it's not really exactly what you want. Because oftentimes you really want to have content that kind of fits into your site. You don't want to have some randomly generated content because maybe it doesn't fit in with your design. Or also sometimes you want to test some specific edge cases, like with the nodes that are referencing each other, or with like private content that's only accessible to some people. So certain special cases, and Devil Generate basically just generates some random nodes for you, and so you really want sort of specific content tailored to your site. And also for automated testing, generally you want to, if you're going to write a test for your content, you want to make sure that like a certain string is there. And this obviously doesn't work with randomly generated content. So that's also not a really, really good solution. Okay. And then, the third sort of solution, and this is actually in some senses, or in some sense, a pretty decent solution sometimes, is actually just taking a live, an SQL dump from your live site and import it to your local development site. In this case, I use the address command to do that if you have your site aliases set up properly, but it's the same thing if you just like literally download an SQL dump and import it with PHP management or whatever. And that's actually, that can actually work, and then at that point you actually have the live content, so that actually makes your site fully usable and useful for your local development. This is then, in this case, sort of the difference to what I showed earlier. This is the same site, but this time with actual default content. This is the default vendor distribution. Now we see that you have some menu links at the top, and you have content and images. And this also shows you the difference between like proper default content and the developer-generated content. You know, this now actually becomes a useful site. But as you can probably imagine, I'm not just going to stop there and say this is the solution, because there are actually a bunch of problems associated with copying SQL dumps around all the time. So the first thing that you really need to consider when you start doing that is authorization. So who has access to an SQL dump that you generate? If you're working on a site alone, then this can actually be maybe a good workflow, because you're the only person that needs access to this, and you can just pull down the SQL dump yourself and import it locally. But if you're working with a larger team, and maybe you're working together with freelancers, and then you really need to make sure that you don't run into any issues with that your freelancers have access to data that they shouldn't have. And also, if you want to use this in testing, then you need to somehow make sure that your test runner, whatever that is, has access to a SQL dump, and maybe you probably don't want your SQL, your test runner to actually like SSH into the live server and pull a SQL dump there, so you probably have to put it there and like have a script running that puts it there periodically. So this can actually be a pretty big problem. Probably an even larger problem is that you generally really need to make sure that you just don't take the literal SQL dump, but somehow process it and sanitize it so that your developers don't have access to live email addresses or password caches. Otherwise, they can just go to the live site and log in, which is not something you generally want. And there are also other things like session IDs in the live database. So these are all sort of things that you really need to consider and really sort of make sure that you have a proper setup and a proper workflow for this. Otherwise, you're just going to run into security issues. Another issue is portability. So sometimes, for instance, there will be like an absolute URL somehow end up in the Drupal database in some cache or something, and then this won't work locally because you have a different domain. Or also, if you're working with different developers and maybe some developer wants to use PostgreSQL or SQLite or something like that, and you hand them a MySQL dump, then they can't do anything with it. So, but I think the sanitization is really like the biggest issue, that you basically can just completely, that you really need to take care of when you're working with database dumps. So, these are some of the problems. And so how can we avoid this? And this is basically the thing that I really want to talk to you about. We can avoid all this with using default content, and this is sort of a description of what is default content actually. So since you have a repository where your site is managed, you want to have files in that repository that are automatically provide this content when you install Drupal fresh. So either you have some installation profile, or you use config installer, or you have some custom bash script that installs your site, and as part of this sort of automatic installation, you want to, at the end of this installation process, you want to have fully populated site with content. That's sort of the idea. And a different formulation of the same sentence, now using the default content, the word default content sort of defines what I'm actually talking about. So that's basically the idea. And this solves basically all of the problems that I just listed. Because if you have the default content files in your repository, you no longer need to take care of like authorization with regards to your SQL dump, because it's just in the repository. So whoever has access to the repository, some freelancer or some developer or some test runner, as soon as she or he has access to the repository, they can generate all the content they need. Also, and I'm going to talk in a minute how to actually generate these content files, but since they don't have any sensitive information, since you basically control what is going in there, you don't put any sensitive information in there, so you also don't need to do any sanitization. And since it's a fresh installation, you get automatic portability, basically. So everyone who can install Drupal can also install your content. So this basically solves all of those problems. There are some downsides to default content, and that's why actually it really depends on your use case. And I don't want to sort of the point of this presentation is not to say sharing SQL dumps is the devil and you always need to use default content, but I think it's sort of a useful thing to have in your toolkit. But you need to consider that there are some downsides. So one thing that you probably all know is that installing Drupal is really, really slow. Especially on your custom site, you're going to have a bunch of custom modules and maybe 100 modules or whatever. And so just reinstalling can get really slow, especially if you install in German, for instance, or in another language. The problem gets even worse if you have a multi-language site, so not just German, but you're installing three or four languages. And then Drupal needs to download all the translation files and everything. So this can get really, really slow. And it's way slower than just importing an SQL dump. The second problem is that depending on how deeply you actually want to test your content or test your site, you may actually need a lot of default content. So I put this image here just as an example. So to actually test all the different features of this pager, so to actually have all the different links with the first and previous, you need I don't know how many hundreds of pieces of content. So this can be sort of a tedious process to generate all this content. But it really depends. Sometimes you don't often have maybe this big pager, or maybe you don't want to test it in every single case. But it's definitely something to consider. Okay, so that was basically sort of the introduction, what is default content and why can it be useful. So now I sort of want to get into how you can actually achieve that with Drupal. So are there any questions up to this point, any comments, anything? Okay, so again, in general, I really would like everyone here to kind of walk away with some understanding of how to actually use this in practice. So if you have any if anything is unclear, or if you have any comments, just tell me.
Maybe just if I were trying to speak only about the implementation development phase, or is that more generally also possible to apply over a production environment, what you are presenting or the problems that you are confronting now?
Okay, so the question was whether this is only useful for your local development site or whether it can also be used in production, right? Just repeating for the recording. I guess, I don't know. My primary use case is for local development, so that's basically how I always think about it. I don't know if it can be useful. It definitely can be useful in production. It depends on your use case. For instance, we had in the Thunder, for instance, menu links. That's something that basically is depending on how you implement it, but can be content in Drupal. It can be a content entity. So, and but you always want your menu to be there. You want to be there in this exact form. You don't want to just have a random menu. So this is something that I think can be useful for introduction. But you know, I guess it kind of depends. Okay, any more questions? Okay, then let's get into how we can actually do this with Drupal. So in Drupal core, we cannot do this at all. There's no mechanism in this like this at all. There's been a lot of discussion for years and years, and this is something that you know, the slide I showed about the default Drupal 8 installation, that's not very good marketing for Drupal. Like, people who install Drupal for the very first time look at this and say, like, man, this is like shit. So it's always been like a big discussion in the community to be able to do this in core, but we cannot at this moment. But there are a bunch of, or there are actually two contract modules that can do this, and the most popular is the default content module that maybe some of you know already. And yeah, I'm going to go into both of them. And the second one is the migrate default content. That's kind of like the new kid on the block. And it's, yeah. So I'm going to basically show the two different modules. Both of them have some advantages, disadvantages. The default content module is a little bit more sort of like established, a little bit more stable. And the migrate default content is a little bit newer, so a little bit less finished, I guess, at this point. But yeah, so just going to go into both of them and then sort of compare them. So, right, so let's start with the default content module. It, the default content module uses the whole REST subsystem that's now shipped with Drupal 8. So I want to sort of explain how it works conceptually. So if you think about Drupal classically, how probably many of us use Drupal on a daily basis is that you have like your Drupal database, and Drupal interacts, or Drupal talks directly to the browser, to the user. So basically, Drupal outputs the HTML in the browser. This is sort of the arrow to the right. And then you have like a form, and you input your content, and you post your content back to the database. So this is like the arrow to the left. And REST kind of revolutionizes this whole concept, I guess, by having this standardized format in the middle there. So basically, the Drupal database, or Drupal in itself, doesn't actually output the HTML anymore, but it outputs this HelloJSON in this case. Like, if you don't know what HelloJSON is, it doesn't really matter, but for the fact that it's like a standardized JSON format for the content. And Drupal outputs this, and then your native iOS app or your Ember.js frontend or whatever can read this HelloJSON. And so this would again be like sort of the arrows to the right, but then also your Ember.js frontend can have like a form, and it can post back to, in this HelloJSON format, back to your Drupal site and update the content. So that's basically REST. The REST module in core that has nothing to do with default content. But default content basically says, so, okay, if I have this standardized format of getting content out of Drupal, why don't I just use that and put that standardized format into files and put those files in the repository, and then I'm basically done. Because we already have this sort of mechanism to get content in and out of Drupal in this way. So that's basically what the default content module does. And yeah, so this is again sort of the same thing, but here I've split it up basically into the two directions. So we're first going to look at the top row, which is basically you have these files in this HelloJSON format in your repository, and the default content module basically imports them into your Drupal database, and then afterwards I'm going to talk about how you can do the reverse of basically getting your content that you have maybe manually clicked together, how you can export them into these files using the default content module. Exactly. So let me just get some water. So how the default content module works is that all the content So you need to create like a custom module for this, or you can also, if you have a custom installation profile, you can also put it in the profile. And basically, so this is like a normal module. You have like your info file and some folders, maybe a config folder. And with default content, you get a new directory or a folder in your module called content. And inside of this content folder are a bunch of other folders. And basically the, sorry, that was kind of a weird explanation. So basically how this works is that the different files, all the different JSON files, are grouped by entity type. So in Drupal, I don't know how experienced all of you are with this, but in Drupal we have different types of entities. I guess the most common entity is the node one, which is where you have all your different content types and stuff like that, but you also have taxonomy terms, users, blocks, and stuff like that. And so the files are basically grouped by the entity type. And so inside of this content folder, you have the different folders for your entity types, and inside of that, you have the actual JSON files with the actual content. So I'm going to give one example here of one of these JSON files. So this is the this HAL JSON format, and as you can see, this is kind of a lot of stuff in here, all the different values. This is the node title, and then there's a lot of other stuff, and then there's also the body at some point. And so what happens, so in this example, I have like this a custom module called my module, and I have this JSON file in the content directory, and then inside in this node directory, and then what happens? If I install this module, the default content module basically creates this node for me, and I have this node on my site. That's basically the idea. So pretty simple, but really, really useful. So that was that part. So now the question is, how do I get this really weird and long crazy file in my file system, because obviously I don't want to write this by hand, because no one can write this by hand. And you don't need to, which is nice, because there's a bunch of Drush commands for that. So basically there's a command, if you basically already know which piece of content you want to export, there's just a command called default content export, which you give the entity type and the ID, so node 1 in this case, and you tell it what the file name should be, and then it will put it there. So very easy. And then there are a bunch of other commands that which can do a little bit more useful stuff. So there's also a command, default content export references. So this will export your node, but also any content that is referenced by this node. So this is very, very useful if you're using paragraphs, for example, because then the node, if you're using paragraphs, the node doesn't actually contain any content, but the node contains paragraphs, and these paragraphs contain the content, or maybe these paragraphs contain other paragraphs, or they contain media entities and stuff like that. And you don't actually want to go and type like this default content command like 50 different times for all your different paragraph IDs, but you just want to have this one node with all its references. And you can do that. So you can just say default content export references, and tell it basically the location of this content folder, and then it will properly group all the different entities in the subdirectories there. And there's also, so this was default content export references with the node for node 1. And then you can also basically just leave out the ID, and then it will just export all nodes on the system. So this is very useful if you're like basically starting fresh and then click together a bunch of different nodes that you want on your site, and then just use this command and you're done. Thank you, Florian, by the way, for telling me this yesterday. Mm-hmm. I didn't know this. But it's very cool. And then there's also a different another command, if you, I haven't actually used this before, but there's also the mechanism that you can actually predefine a bunch of different content items that you want in a specific module in your info YAML file. And then you just need to basically look up the UUID of the different of the nodes and the blocks or whatever, and you put them in your info file. And then, info content will export them. And this is also, I think this is particularly useful for continuously updating. If you have like a set of content that you regularly update and keep up to date or add to it, then you can just use this command, default content export module with the module name, and it will basically just go through and look for all the content and just put it there. Yeah. So pretty easy and pretty useful. Any particularly questions for the fresh stuff? Okay, so. Yeah, so that was basically the rundown of how default content works. Basically, we saw how it works to import the files, which is basically just installing the module, and then how you can export it just using Drush. And this is really useful. Because it builds on the generic REST component in Drupal 8, it works for every entity type. So if you install media or paragraphs or commerce or some other stuff that comes with custom entity types, it just works. There's nothing you need to do, it just works. And you don't need to configure anything. That's really nice. It basically imports automatically. You just need to sort of make sure that this module is installed, maybe as part of your installation profile or installation script. And we just saw that there's also Drush support, so that's very nice. There are also some problems with the default content, which are sort of also like the downside of using the REST module. REST module doesn't really work with with files and core. So if you want to have like images or in general files as part of your default content, this doesn't work with Drupal core at all. But this is fixed by the contributed file entity module. There's also a better normalizes module, which I'll link later, which basically, if you don't want to use file entity, which also sort of fixes this particular issue with REST. This is kind of annoying. Also, path aliases don't work, which is again not the fault of the default content module, but more the fault of the REST module. There's again this default content extras module, which kind of fixes this with a workaround. Menu links are also a little bit strange. Generally, they work because they are also just entities. But if you have menu links that reference content, in the Drupal UI, you can like create a menu link by auto-completing by like the node title. And if you do that, your menu link will actually reference the node ID, like the integer ID. And that's kind of problematic with default content because you cannot predetermine the integer ID. So it doesn't necessarily not work, but it's kind of weird with menu links. And also one downside is this verbose output that I just showed you, this really crazy hell JSON file. It's not really, not really readable, or also not really editable. If you want to like manually update it or something like that, it's possible, but kind of not very nice. Also some things that are sort of specific to default content. The UUIDs as file names can get kind of annoying, especially if you have, like I said earlier, if you have like a node that references a paragraph, that references media, that references a file entity, and there's something like broken in this chain and you want to figure out what's going on, you need to like walk through 15 different files and they're just referencing each other by UUID, so you have no idea what's going on. It can get kind of annoying. Also, there's no support for re-importing. So basically, once you've installed your default content module, you have all your content. It looks really nice and awesome. And then if you uninstall the module again, or you somehow want to like update your content, you can't basically uninstall and reinstall the module. You need to really install your complete site from scratch, which is kind of, especially when you're in the process of like updating the default content, this can be pretty annoying. I put a little asterisk there because there's an issue for this, and it's like pretty close to getting committed, so maybe this will change in the future, but at this point, at this time, it just doesn't work. Also, this does not work currently. The default content module does not work with configuration import. So if you're, for instance, using the config installer profile and are installing your default content, like your the content module, the my module content thingy, as part of your config installer routine, then the content will not get created. There's a bug currently that prevents this, and that's also kind of annoying. And also, this is probably going to get fixed pretty soon, but currently it's broken, so that's pretty bad. Yeah, so that was kind of the rundown of the default content module.
I have a question.
Yes.
How about revisions? So could I import a node which has a history?
No, that's actually a very good question. So in core, there's also no like REST. The REST subsystem does not support revisions at all. No, you can't. That's a very good question. Yeah.
Can I have two sets of default content? Like one with like menu items or blog content that I actually want on the production site later, and some with the kind of filling up content to have something to look at while I'm working on my left side?
Yeah, that actually, I should repeat the question. So the question was whether you can have two different sets of default content for your production site or your left side. That actually works. So default content will generally just as soon as you're installing any module, it will just look, is there a content directory, and then it will just import it. So you can split that up however you want in different modules or something like that. That will work fine.
So you go down the outside of the default content.
Yeah.
That requires files entity. What about files export? Like the whole thing is migrated by DCS, like version control systems, I assume, on production, on stage, on such, make the default content, generate the default content. So what about files? Those also need to be migrated, or?
Yeah, so the question was how the file entity actually, file entity integration actually works. So how this works is that basically, yeah, so the file content, so the actual file basically, is base64 encoded and added to this hell.json file of the file entity, basically. So you don't have an actual, this is also something that I find kind of annoying. So you don't actually have like an image file as part of your repository, but you have this weird long string that you cannot read or anything. So, but that's how it works. Yeah, exactly. So, first of all, yeah, it's not for a fresh install, and also it's kind of problematic if you already have the file there because you like copied them over previously and then you install again and you try to basically create the file with the same name, then Drupal will like add the prefix at the end. So it doesn't really help you to copy the files over. So you really need to use this file entity integration, which basically adds the base64 encoded string there. And then it works fine, but yeah, it's kind of annoying. So that was basically the default content module. Now I'm going to show the migrate default content, which sort of some of the things that I listed here as downsides are sort of solved better by the migrate default content module, I think. But then there are also a bunch of downsides as well, so it's kind of, I don't know. I guess you have to decide for yourself and also decide on your use case. So, okay, so the migrate default content module uses the migrate module in core, very little surprisingly. And how migrate works is basically, in general, that you have a Drupal 6 or Drupal 7 database and sort of access that content and use that to fill your content in your Drupal 8 database. But the migrate subsystem is very pluggable, so all parts of this chain are plugins. So the migrate default content module basically says, okay, also the sort of the sources, the migrate sources are plugins. So migrate default content says, okay, why don't I just use basically simple files as sources of the migration, and then use that to import the content into my Drupal database. So very simple concept. Let's see how that actually works. So the migrate default content module comes with a very simple settings file that just contains the source directory, and this source directory contains all configurations. So with this module, with migrate default content, the content no longer belongs to a specific module, but it's like for a site instance. So you have one directory for your entire site that contains all the content that you want to import with migration. So this, depending on your use case, can be a good thing, can be a bad thing. Asked earlier, if you can, like with default content, like I said, you can sort of have different modules that take part of different parts of your content. This is not possible with migrate default content because it's just one directory for all your content. Also, this is kind of interesting. I guess that there's no user interface for this. I don't know why, but they didn't make like a form to put this to configure the source directory. So you just need to edit the configuration by hand, which is a little bit strange. Okay. So and then if you have this directory configured, how this works in practice is that you no longer have one file for each like content item, but you have one file for each entity type and bundle here. So for example, for every content type, as you can see here, there is one file, so node article. And all articles that you want to create are inside this file. And all page nodes are inside another file, and all terms are in another file, and so forth. And as you can see also, this migrate default content uses the YAML file format, which I think is kind of nice because it makes it more readable, but I guess it's arguable as well. So this is sort of the layout of the files, and if we look inside one particular file, for example in the node cache one, you see, I don't know if you are all familiar with the YAML format in general, but what we can see here is that basically each piece of content is like one block inside of the YAML file. So for each of these things, one node will be created, and it basically just uses a very simple key value format. So I can just put the title and set like a status field to false. That's sort of the basic layout. And then there are some a little bit quirky, strange things that you can see here. So title is just a normal field. I can just set it, just by setting the value. But the body field, for example, on nodes, this has actually two properties, because with the body, as soon as you have like a CK editor or something like that, you always need to have both the content and the actual text format that's used with this content. So it consists of like two properties. And the way this is handled with migrate default content is in this very strange syntax of like camel casing the property. So the field name is body, and then the property is value, and then so they camel case the value, you can see that it just looks kind of strange. And it looks even more strange if you have like an image field, for example, with an underscore. So you have, this is the field name, like field image. And then the property in this case is target ID, and then has a capital T. So yeah, it's kind of strange, but it works. And also what you can see here, this is pretty nice. I put here actually just the file name of an actual image file, and how this works is that inside of this default content directory, I have another directory called files, and I just put my files there, and then I can reference them in my YAML file, and then the migrate default content will just handle that for me automatically. Like, it will create a file entity out of all these out of all the files, and then I can reference them in image fields or whatever. So this is actually something I find a lot nicer than in the normal default content module. And I want to talk about anything else. No, I think that was pretty much it. Also something that is very useful, especially if you have like a lot of complex, or yeah, if you have a lot of content that you're managing, you can actually override how this migration basically works, how this content will be important. I don't want to go into this too much because it's a little bit, yeah, it's maybe a little bit of an edge case, but it can be pretty useful. I just gave like one example here in this case that, for instance, if you want to have a default value, if you want to implement a default value for all of your imported content, you can just do this by specifying like an override file. There's another override directory, and you can have basically for each migration, you have the ability to override it. And then you can say, for example, for this particular field, I want to have a default value, for example, some tag that automatically gets added to all my content. And this can be pretty useful. And there's a bunch of other things that you can do. Basically, I don't know if any of you are familiar with the migration API in Drupal 8. Basically, you can use any plugin, any process plugin that's provided by the migration API. So you can do a lot of useful stuff here. Yeah, but I don't want to get too much into it because it is kind of an edge case, but it can be pretty useful. Okay, so that's basically how it works. That's basically how the files look in the file system. And then when you actually want to get them into your Drupal site, what you have to do is run a drush migrate import command. Drush, unfortunately, doesn't actually come with such a command itself, so you need the migrate tools contrib module. And then you need to run this command, drush migrate import, and give it this tag. So the migrate default content module creates a bunch of different migrations, and they're all tagged with the module name. And so if you just run this command, basically, it will import all the migrations that you've specified. And also, what's pretty useful is that this migrate import command has a bunch of different flags and a bunch of different ways of operating, which can be very useful. The first one that I want to highlight is the update flag. So contrary to the default content module, the migrate default content actually can be updated, like on your existing site. So if you've updated your default content in your YAML file, you don't really need to reinstall. You can just like rerun the migration, and it will update the default content. So that's pretty useful. And you can also just run one particular migration if you want. So you can, for instance, in this particular case, just import the article nodes by specifying this the name of the migration. Again, if you have, for instance, like entity references or paragraphs or something like that, you can also make sure that the dependent migrations are executed as well beforehand. So this is pretty useful. In theory, you can also like import specific nodes even within this migration, stuff like that. So this migrate import command is pretty powerful and pretty useful. So that was basically the migrate default content. Unfortunately, there's no, because the migrate subsystem does not provide this, there is no way to actually like export your content into these YAML files. So you do have to like write them by hand, which is obviously a downside. So So that was basically the showcase. Yeah, so some benefits is that it's like I showed, it's pretty flexible in terms of the import. You can, like I said, you can override the import. You can also what's really nice is that entity references don't work by, so you don't need to reference them by like ID or UUID, which can get kind of very unreadable, but you can actually just use the title, for example. So if you have a bunch of tags or a bunch of nodes or something like that, and you want to reference them between each other, you can just reference them by the title, by the label, which is, just looks very nice then in the exported files. As I showed, files are natively supported, which is pretty nice, and I think that's it, yeah. Yeah, and then the downsides are that there is no export support. So you do really need to write your content by hand, which, I mean, depending on your site, is not very realistic. I mean, but on the other hand, you have full control over over your default content, and you don't get this massive blob of hell stuff. So really depends on your use case, but it is obviously a downside. Because it's not tied to a module, you need to explicitly run the migration as part of like your installation script or something like that, because it's not it's not automatic like with default content. And depending on how much content you have, because all content for a single bundle is in one single file, this file can obviously get really, really large, especially if you like, have a lot of fields, then each single content will be maybe 10 or 15 lines, and then if you multiply this by 50 or something, you just have a very large file, which is also kind of annoying. And then, like I said, this very strange syntax for like fields with multiple properties and stuff like that. It kind of just looks pretty ugly and is a strange way of doing it. It also currently does not, currently does not work with entity reference revisions. So it actually, this was fixed in the development version recently, but the stable version of this module doesn't support this. And also there's some specific problems even in the latest development versions with paragraphs. So that's kind of unfortunate. Okay, I see we're kind of a little bit late, so I'm just gonna rush. Or wait, is there any questions to this module in particular? I'm just gonna, basically the rest is just a little bit of a comparison between the modules, and then I'm basically done. So, but any specific questions to this module? Okay, yeah, so I'm just gonna give a brief rundown, basically to help you maybe decide which of these strategies could be something for you. So in terms of a stable release, default content is currently in alpha. With migrate default content, it's kind of complicated because itself is stable, but it depends on other modules that are in dev. But then these dependencies were recently removed in the dev version. So if you use the dev version, then you don't need other dev dependencies. So I put dev. I think that's fair, even though there's a stable release. That's also why counting the dependencies is kind of complicated, because currently there's 4 in the stable release, but there's 0 in the dev release, but then also because you need the migrate tools to actually run the import, and that has another dependency, so it's kind of 2 still, so whatever. Yeah, and like I said, the default content module is sort of the more established module that's used by a bunch of large organizations and developed by it. And migrate default content is still sort of the new kid on the block and not as finished, so there's not that many people using it yet. Maybe that will change, but that's sort of still something to consider when, if you want to use it. Like I said, there's no way to export it, the migrate default content with Drush, Unfortunately, there's no UI for either of the modules, so even with the default content module, you do have to use Drush. On the other hand, you can only re-import with the migrate default content, so yeah, I guess I talked about that as well. Like I said, the file format is different, and also the location of the files is a little bit different. I guess we talked about that as well. And then just some list of integrations with different entity types. In general, they both support entity reference. Like I said, files are kind of supported with default content, but only if you have the file entity module. Path aliases, again, need this extra module to work. Menu links, like I said, are also kind of weird, and all of this is a lot easier with the migrate default content, which is also why I like it a little bit better. Shortcuts are basically the same thing as menu links, so they also kind of work with default content, but work fine with the migrate one. On the other hand, like I said, entry reference revisions doesn't really work with migrate default content. Paragraphs, not either. And so this is just basically, if you want to follow along at home, some links to all the different modules. So these are basically the main modules. This is the extra modules for menu link support. This is the file entity one to work with files, and the better normalizers module also comes with this file integration. I don't know why they duplicated it. And then the migrate default content, these are the four dependencies of the migrate default content. And these, the source ones, are no longer required in dev. But you need, like I said, you need migrate tools and migrate plus for the brush command. So, that's basically it. Are there any more questions?
Could create a default content with migrate RP at all without the module in particular? Or, so if you have a source of content somewhere, you can just plug in your migrate there. Just without repository.
Exactly. So basically, the migrate default content basically just is this missing link of like automatically generating a migration from your YAML files that you just put there. Yes, basically it just uses the migrate system.
Do you evaluate
realistic dummy
content module?
No, I've never heard of that.
Oh, okay. So it seems to be a better way to integrate with the low temperature, but with given text and units.
Ah, that's interesting. Realistic dummy content. I've never heard of it, but I'm going to try it out, I guess. Because this is still, as you can see, this is not like, I guess, a solved problem, at least not a fully solved problem. There's like, I kind of currently like the migrate one a little bit better, but, it's not really,
Excellent.
Yeah.